Hello and welcome to the latest episode of the Goodrum Show with me, Chris Goodrum. Right, this afternoon. I had intended to do a slightly different episode of the show this week, but unfortunately a couple of the samples haven't arrived as yet, so that one is going to be put on hold for a bit. But there's always something to share with you guys, and we're going to carry on with the Age of Sedum Scottish Distilleries. And as you've obviously seen from the title page, we have got to M. So M is, well, I could have done Milton Duff, I suppose. That's a pleasant enough kind of malt. I could have tortured myself with McDuff, I suppose. You know, that might have been interesting. But no, I'm going to go for Macallan. Now, this is me talking, so, you know, I'm not the world's biggest fan of sherry cask whiskey, so there's always going to be a twist, isn't there? And hopefully this little episode of the show won't disappoint you. But anyway, as per usual, let's have a bit of a potted history of the distillery. Right, so the distillery itself is a pretty damn big one. It's about, I think it's the fourth largest distillery in the whole of Scotland. It certainly has a production capacity of 9.4 million litres. So it's pretty damn big, and I think there's only sort of Glenlivet and Glenmorangie, I think, bigger. Rossyle. But anyway, looking through the history, the sort of like the abbreviated history of the distillery, it's well, not boring, but there's not an awful lot that's gone on, it has to be said. You know, it's just a question of sort of like, you know, being bought and sold and increased in capacities, more stills, etc., etc. There's no fires, no ghosts, no, you know, weird and wonderful happenings. I mean, it's all been sort of, you know, since 1824, it's passed through a few hands. I mean, it was originally, the license was originally given to some guy called Alexander Reed, who died, and then it got taken over by someone called James Stewart, who died, or I think he might have sold it before he died. I don't quite know which one, but he then sold it to somebody called Roderick Kemp, who, yeah, you guessed it, he died. And the family set up a trust to sort of like run the distillery, and it ran that distillery right the way through until late 60s, 1966, apparently, when it became a public limited company, was floated on the stock exchange, and 20 years later, Suntory buys 25% of the shares of it, and another 10 years later, a company called Highland Distilleries buys all the rest of the shares, and then another sort of few years later, Edrington and William Grant gets together and buys out Highland Distilleries, and, you know, so you kind of get the feeling. It's all corporate stuff, really, and, you know, certainly the distillery itself can't be seen as some kind of like nice little cozy little sort of Edradori kind of thing. No, it's a damn behemoth, and it's good at what it does, you know. Considering sort of sales are somewhere in the region of, I did read it somewhere around here, saying millions and millions of bottles basically a year of Macallan are sold, and Macallan sort of regularly tops kind of like auctions with sort of like some seriously old bottlings that have been done. And it's probably a bit like Ardbeg, you know, there's people that are absolutely nuts about it, will drink nothing else and just love all that big sherry and all that kind of stuff. And, well, you know, I mean, okay, so, yeah, that's great. But there is another side to Macallan, and that is what was the Fine Oak series that they released some years ago, whereby instead of it all being completely obliterated by sherry, they actually used some American oak aged spirit, which gave you a kind of insight into the actual character of the distillery. And you know that my feelings on sherried whiskies. You know that sort of like, you know, your 10-year-old sherry is generally, you know, first fill Oloroso, you're not going to get any distillery character. It could be anything. And frankly, you know, the old 10-year-old Macallan, I just thought was, well, boring. Older expressions, yeah, okay, so you get the, you know, the sort of wood characters, the old, the maturation, the sort of the oxidization characters, and it's a, yeah, they're kind of quite interesting and certainly moving in either kind of cognac-y or armagnac-y way, as I've said on numerous occasions, and so therefore you get some complexity from the wood and the aging, and you kind of go, okay, so I'm not going to get any distillery character, and you just enjoy them for what they are, and some of them are absolutely gorgeous, but sort of, you know, your younger malts, I want some character, and I love the fine oak range because of that fact, and this is where the twist in today's little tasting comes, because the distillery doesn't really do an awful lot with the stuff that it sticks into American oak casks, it sells it to the independents, and the independents bottle it. Excellent. So today's tasting is basically all American oak aged Macallan, with one exception, which is only finished in ex-sherry casks. Whether that was finished at the distillery or finished by the independent, I couldn't honestly tell you, but I'm guessing probably finished by the independent company that bottled it. So hopefully this will be a really interesting insight into what the character of Macallan actually is. Right, I'll introduce this afternoon's little lineup. All the thoughts I've locked inside. Right, okay, so I've just gone on about distillery character, and what am I going to taste first? A Murray McDavid whiskey that's been finished in an Exichem cask. All right, yeah, okay. But no, this should be hopefully quite interesting. It is a 14-year-old. It was distilled in 1995, bottled in 2009, so this is a real archive bottling, it has to be said, and was bottled at 46%. So, yeah, Exichem cask finish, so should add some sweetness, could be interesting. Then we're going to get into the tasting properly, I suppose, and the next bottling we'll be looking at is a 16-year-old. It was bottled by Hunter Laing in the Old Malt Cask series, distilled in October of 1997 and bottled in August of 2014. Next one is an 18-year-old. This is also in the Old Malt Cask series, but this was bottled by Douglas Laing when it was, you know, back then. This was distilled in December of 1993 and bottled in December of 2012. The fourth bottling we'll be looking at was by A.D. Rattray. This was distilled in 1991, bottled in 2010, bottled at 58.8%, single cask, 4135, so should be interesting. And then we go on to the two old ones. This was, again, another Douglas Laing Old Malt Cask bottling. This time it was distilled in May of 1990, bottled in July of 2011, thus making it 21 years old, and I believe the cask reference was DL7090. I should have looked up the other ones, but I haven't. And then finally, hopefully this one will be the pièce de résistance, as they say in Paris. This is from Hunter Laing's Old and Rare series, so I think this was about 400 and something odd pounds a bottle, which is, you know, for a 25-year-old Macallan, I suppose it's actually relatively cheap when you think about it. This was distilled in February of 1990, bottled in February of last year. Like I said earlier on, this has been sherry finished and is 25 years old and was bottled at 51.8. So hopefully this will be, like I said, a really interesting insight into the distillery, the character of the malt, sans being obliterated by sherry. Right, okay, so let's kick off this merry little tasting with the Murray McDavid bottling then, shall we? Aromatic, sweet, there's a real sort of grapey, dried grape sweetness. Not a sherry dried grape, but obviously the Akem kind of dried white grape sweetness, I should say. got real vibrancy to it. Even after all these years in a sample bottle, the vibrancy is really impressive. Quite mineral, a lot of citrus notes, barley, bit of kind of creamy American oak. Oh, I mean, that is just amazingly well balanced. And I remember when we used to stock this stuff, you know, this was an absolutely gorgeous bottling, and that sample has just, you know, held up really nicely. So yeah, I mean, this is it. It's just kind of like classic American oak Macallan with a bit more sweetness. And, you know, this is just, you know, what, if you're going to finish it, ace it, or whatever you want to call it, in a wine cask, this is what you want. You want the balance. You want it just to add a little bit of something, but not to be too overpowering. And this was actually really, really, and still is really, really nice. Getting a little bit of almost kind of toffee bananas now, so. Palate? Oh, that's quite dry. Dry, slightly chocolatey. Again, a lot of sort of dried grape. Initially quite sweet with some barley and some citrus. I think it's getting a little bit old now because it is starting to get a little bit, not rough at the edges, but a little bit sort of edgy, shall we say. And I don't remember it being like that. But then again, that was 2009, and a long time ago in whiskey terms. Or whiskey tasting terms, I should say. But again, you know, maybe with the dryness aside, it's still really nice, full, juicy. Probably could have done going on a little bit longer, but like I said, it's probably more down to the age of the samples more than anything else. But yeah, nice start, by the way. Moving on to the 16-year-old. Let's see what the nose gives us on this then, shall we? Ooh, that's a bit of an oak monster. Now, that's a lot of, I would guess, first fill American oak. Really buttery and lightly nutty. In saying that, there is still a little bit of citrus character coming through, a little bit of barley. I mean, yes, the oak is very, very much in your face and in control. But there is still something else going on beneath it. Now, if this had been first fill Oloroso 16-year-old, I don't think you'd have got much past the Oloroso, it has to be said. Still, it's pretty heavy on the oak. Palate? Lot less oak on the palate, in actual fact. A lot better balance, more citrus, more barley, a little bit of honey possibly, and the oak is all kind of sitting nicely in the background. And this is the interesting thing with a lot of whiskies, you know, you sort of smell them and you think, oh, you know, that's going to give me an indication of what's to come on the palate, and then suddenly it just completely throws you a curveball. And you know, it just flips over and you go, where's all that oak gone? It's just all the citrus and what have you. I think the sample is kind of starting to break down a little bit, and I did notice when I picked up the sample bottles, the sample case that I had, put them all the bottles in, there was one or two that had, shall we say, evaporated, because they do. And but you know, that is a lovely whiskey. Again, just like I said, it shows you the sort of like how a nose can be completely and utterly different to the palate. Really quite impressive. The other side. Okay, so let's move on to the 18-year-old. Let's see what nose gives us on this end, shall we? Now, that's a better balanced nose. Really has some quite amazing maturity to it. It's got that kind of straw-like dried fruit kind of character. Some barley. a little bit of toasty oak, quite herbal in actual fact. It's almost kind of, sort of, rye kind of, you know, subtly characteristic. A little bit of coffee, some malt. Not quite citric. Does seem to be a slight absence of the citrus notes, but and it's a little bit more malty, like I said, a little bit, you know, some nice barley, some honey, and that real sort of herbal note kind of mingling in with the sort of the maltiness. So, yeah, now that's pretty different. Palate? A little bit short, but there's some nice honeyed sweetness kind of creeping back. Maybe it's a little bit, not hollow, but kind of, it's a bit stop-start, it has to be said. But this is one of those whiskies where the palate is pretty much replicating the nose. It's sort of like fairly softly oaked, quite malty, quite broad, very upfront. And then, like I said, you kind of get almost this kind of stop-start effect where you go, yeah, that's nice. And then, And then, yeah, some nice honey kind of coming in through the finish. So, yeah, pleasant. I mean, it just feels like a sort of a weighty kind of spay. So, yeah, nice. So hold me close just one last time. Okay, so moving on to the first of the two cask strength bottlings. This is the... yes, that is indeed the Rattray 19-year-old. Let's see what those gives us on this end, shall we? Now again, that's got that kind of nice herbally kind of character, that sort of slight straw-like, mature white fruits, apricot, apple, little bit of honey. That is absolutely gorgeous. That is really elegant, aromatic, perfumed but not overly perfumed. Some lovely barley character, you know, a real, again, quite weighty spay kind of character. Little bit of oak kind of coming through with some thyme. Some nice fruit, very fleshy, weighty. Absolutely gorgeous. That's how I like my Macallan, it has to be said. A little bit of coffee now. Really, really complex. This is a great bottle. Palate? Edgy, not rough, but kind of natural feeling. A little sort of, like I said, edgy at the edges. Coffeed, malty, some big barley, chewy, quite herbal on the middle. Alcohol does kind of mask the finish a little bit, but gives it a lovely vibrancy, a slight sort of mouth-watering character, as some of the sort of juicier citrus notes kind of come in as well. Yeah, that is really very, very impressive. It's just got that lovely natural kind of character to it. What more can you say? Say something to hurt me, please. Just make this right. 21-year-old Macallan. Now, I can't remember what this would have retailed for, but it ain't going to be cheap. But let's see what the notes are saying, shall we? Mature, again, that sort of slightly straw-like fruit, dusty spice. This is actually the first time in all of these, I've actually got some sort of spice kind of character coming through. And it's very soft and it's very dusty. a little bit of buttery oak, a little bit of sawdusty oak. Again, quite a weighty spirit, quite broad. Mind you, the oak is kind of like helping do that. It's certainly sort of developing and becoming more buttery. But it is just really well balanced. There's just enough citrus. There's a little bit of lime, a touch of lemon possibly, that kind of thing, just to sort of give it a little bit of balance. Oh, that's lovely. Elegant, just wonderfully elegant. Little bit of dried fruit just coming through on the finish, some lovely honey. Oh, that just glides, that is gorgeous. So creamy oak, again, broad, juicy, fruity, little bit of citrus just to sort of like, you know, stop it all becoming a bit too flabby. Amazingly long. I mean, this just shows you that the quality of the spirit that Macallan is producing is bloody good. Well, certainly give it to 21 years in a cask. Why not sort of bottle it like this? Why not show what the distillery is capable of doing? And yes, they did it with the fine oak, but what's wrong with having maybe, you know, a sherry lineup if you want, you know, and then bottle some American oak aged versions, you know, do a 10, 12, 18, you know, mirror image kind of thing. I mean, that's what I would certainly be doing, but the trouble is Macallan has built its reputation and what have you on, you know, sherry matured whiskey, and it would obviously be seen to be going kind of against the grain to a certain extent, but I think they probably should, and maybe, you know, if somebody had, but they probably can't, I forget who the distiller's blender's name actually is, you know, it's not, you can't do anything outrageous for God's sake, you know, we're talking about, you know, stock market listed company, you know, you can't do anything weird and wonderful and start playing around with stuff, you know, because shareholders will be going, whoa, you know, so, anyway, but that's gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. And finally, the 400 and something odd pound old and rare bottling. Let's see what those goods on this end, shall we? As Jeremy Clarkson might say, if he was talking about a car. But anyway, oh, that is gorgeous. I mean, the sherry component is obviously... It's coming across more like a refill sherry because it's delicate. There's a little bit of almost Armagnac-y dried fruits. But still, you get all this weighty barley. And actually, the spirit feels pretty fresh. Not necessarily in such a citric way. I guess the alcohol is kind of helping to sort of do that. Even getting a little bit of violets. And a bit of a little intimation of peat smoke. I mean, oh, wow. Yeah, this is damn good. Just wonderfully balanced. The sherry is just doing what it should do, just adding a little bit of characteristic, but not blanketing. And you're getting all that wonderful American oak, the dusty American oak, the barley, the fruit, a little bit of honey. Not quite so herbal, a little bit of spice, but that's probably coming more from the sherry casks than anything else. Harmonious, absolutely gorgeous. Palate. It's a little bit heavier on the sherry on the palate. Quite drying tannins. Obvious Oloroso cask influence. a little bit of cold tea, stewed fruit, prune. But on the finish, you get the American oak coming through and getting the creaminess, the barley. All the while that sort of slightly spicy sherry fruit is still there, but you know, it's kind of just sort of slowly sort of moving from being the dominant characteristic to sort of allowing the sort of sherry, the American oak character to come through. A little bit of spice, bit of toffee, bit of prune, almond. Wow, that's incredible. And that's what I love about great whiskey. Great whiskey has progression. Well, it doesn't always have to have progression. Sometimes it can just sort of go bang, here I am, and sort of, you know, your kind of senses are kind of overwhelmed by the enormity of it. But great whiskey, really great whiskey, has flavour progression as far as I'm concerned, and this really has it. This is sort of like, has a beginning, has a middle, and has an end. And oh, what an ending. I mean, that is absolutely sublime. You know, a little bit of smoke on the finish. Yeah, I can see a song coming there, Smoke on the Macallan. No, maybe not. Anyway, great way to finish. The other side of loving you. So, let's sum this little tasting up. What have we learned? One, Macallan produces some bloody good spirit, it has to be said, and I think it's a crying shame that the distillery don't actually release it. But I guess, you know, where that's one person's loss, another person's gain. You know, keep selling the American oak stuff to the independents, and the independents will bottle it, and people like me can go, buy this because it's different, but it's Macallan, you know. So, individually, the it came and finished Murray McDavid bottling. Yeah, really, really nice. Like I said, kind of classic sort of, you know, idea of how you should finish a whiskey, an ex-wine cask. 16-year-old, yeah, that was quite pleasant. I think the sample was sort of like just showing a little bit of age, shall we say, on the palate. Can't knock the 18-year-old, that was quite nice as well. And probably of the first four, the D Rattray bottling, or AD Rattray bottling, certainly stood out as being really complex, really impressive. Until we got to the final two. The 21-year-old, yep, can't argue with that. It was just lovely, old Macallan. And all of these bottlings, like I said, as I was describing, sort of showed that Macallan's just quite a weighty, space-eyed characteristic, and just absolutely gorgeous. Certainly ages classically in American oak, becoming slightly straw-like. And then, you know, you finish off with the old and rare bottling, and let's say, I don't get scent samples these too often, very often at all, you know, the old and rare stuff. It's obviously just when Douglas Laing are being incredibly generous, so they send them, but yeah, fantastic stuff. So there you have it. That's Macallan with a little bit of a twist. I hope you've enjoyed this week's episode of the show, and I shall enjoy the remnants, the itty bitty remnants of that old and rare Macallan. So until next time, good afternoon and good running.